N minus 1 times LA N minus 1.
Should I start? It's technically class 10. Should I start? It's technically class 10. All right. So, hi everyone. Last time we were looking at tight classes, and that is already a concept which we do not see in Racket. And today we are going to be looking at further things which are quite far away from the Racket domain, and we will learn a few new things. So, last time we looked at this particular type class called ORD. And if you remember what ORD lets us do, is that it lets us compare two elements which are of type ORD. So I have written this particular type. I have this type called 2, and an element of the type 2 is either 0 or 1. And then I have written, I want to derive EQ and ORD on it. So that means, so deriving EQ allows us to compare things of this type using the equality operator. And since I have tried to derive ORD, it will try to define an order on these things. And the order it defines on these things is basically the order of the constructors in which I have written. This is not very useful for most situations, but I just want to use it to illustrate a point. So notice that I could ask GHC for information about ORD, and it gives me a lot of information. One of the information that it gives me is that if I have a type which is ordered, then lists of that type are also ordered. So I have given order on 0 and 1. In particular, 0 is less than 1 and it's not greater than 1. I have this. So this automatically gives me a way to compare between lists which contain type contains this. So the type of these lists are list of 2, but since I have this order defined on each of the elements of this type, it automatically infers an order on the type of lists, which is the lexicographic order, or you can call it the dictionary order if you like. Any questions about this particular thing? No? Okay, that's good. And last time we looked at one thing which was called kind, and we said something like the kind of a particular type is star. And for example, we have like type constructors. For example, there is a list. So by itself, a list is not a type, but it can take something and become a type. Same for maybe. If I have something with two type parameters, then it takes two inputs. So we can also apply this kind operation on type classes, and we can ask what is the type, what is the kind of ORD, and it says that it is a constraint which takes one parameter. Yes.
Just the way I understand this is if you look at type constructors like 8,
yes,
they're actually functions.
Yes. Yes. So
in this world, nice, where it's mathematical, with the world of job mathematical defense, okay? Because you take parameterized classes, the race, the type of coercing this function of types to simply a single type. And if you do the world that way, then it seems strange that maybe would not be a type, right? Because if you think about its ratio, it would just be this one big mass that's made. I think the distinction between in the precise mathematical system, people maybe really isn't a type, people give you a type. So just think about function. You don't confuse functions on the natural numbers with natural numbers. But types are kind of simple data objects in terms of computation.
So for example,
it's a way with this erasure thing. So test, and I think just
so I can illustrate that point. Yeah, this hierarchy of types and kinds are like collapsed in Java and it's difficult to reason with them. That is the point. So I can actually illustrate what you said. So for example, I have this nothing, and nothing is a member of maybe int. It's also a member of maybe A. But if I want to ask whether it's a member of maybe, it says that you can't have a value that lives in maybe because maybe is not a type. It requires a type to be, like, it is a type constructor. So we talked about this in the last class. Just one thing I want to note here is that you can ask what is the kind of these type classes and it will tell you that it is based on. So for example, ORD, the type of ORD is this. It takes a type and it gives you a particular kind of constraint. So we will come back to this in a moment about why this is important. Just keep this in mind. So let me talk about something else for a moment. So remember this definition which we had of this function called map. It's already pretty general in the sense that it is we have abstracted away this type and that type. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to generalize this further. There is one concrete thing over here, and that is the type constructor of lists. We have chosen a specific type constructor that is a type constructor of lists. So I'm going to claim that I can consider similar kinds of things for which a notion of map makes sense. So let us look at this type called binary tree. And a binary tree, so this is a parameter. I can't put type over here because I have multiple constructors. This is a parameter in the sense that this, just like a list could contain several kinds of objects depending on the type, this binary tree is also pretty general. So it's either a leaf or it's a fork containing some data of type A, and then it contains two other trees. I can have a concept of bin tree map, and I could type that like this almost, except that it would be like that. And intuitively, this makes a lot of sense to us. I think this should be small because it's a function, not a just a convention. So if it's a leaf, I just touch the leaf. Or rather, keep the leaf as is. And if it's a fork, then I can apply the function on that data in the fork, and then I can traverse the rest of the tree. I should say if over here, because otherwise it won't type check. Right. So in some sense, that this particular map is very much like this map on lists. So this, both of these are in some sense kind of container types, and the notion of map makes sense on both binary trees as well as lists. I can also consider this particular type, which is called trace, and we have seen this kind of type before. So a trace of A is a function from int to A. And the way to think about this is like, this is a bi-infinite list. So these are the indices. And for each index, you have some value. These are the indices. And maybe for 3, the value is A. For -3, it's A. For something like that. And this is kind of like a bi-infinite list. And it's represented in the form of a function. So we could think of this as a list in some sense, and it makes sense for us to try to generalize the map function for this thing as well. So I would say trace A, arrow trace B. And so call the trace T and the function that we are using to map F. So do you want to think about how this should be implemented? So anyone wants to say anything? Yes. Using compose. That's a good point. So actually, yes. So maybe I could do it in a normal form first, and then I will show everyone why it's using compose. So imagine this particular trace B is like int arrow B, because that is really what it is. I can just write it like that, because it was just a synonym. So if I have to return a function of this type, I first take an integer, which I write with a lambda. I could have written the I on this side as well, and that's fine. So now I have this I, which is an index, and corresponding to that index, I have a particular value, which is T of I. But I can't return T of I. What I want to do is I want to apply F on, which is basically like a compose. Does this make sense to everyone? So imagine, so I could have a trace of characters, which is, let's call it trace A, which is A everywhere. Right. And then I could do trace map, and given some particular character, let's say that I just always want to give the output 1, and then I could apply that on trace A, and that would be a trace of integers or numbers, because it tries to generalize everything. And then I could try to figure out what is this trace at some point. Like I could try to figure out what this trace is at 2 or 3 or wherever it's always 1. So this particular thing is essentially just function composition, like one of you pointed out. So I could write this as f dot t. Any questions about this? Okay. So this particular example is not super important, but what I want everyone to notice is that many of these things have the same type, not quite, but like have the same shape. So there is this, I always take a function A arrow B, and then some type constructor A and some type constructor B. And that here the type constructor is bin tree, here the type constructor is trace, and initially it was list. So instead of considering map, we will call this thing if map, where this is an arbitrary type constructor. And instead of writing a list or some particular type constructor, we will write if. So now it is not the case that you can always do this for any type constructor. It has to make some sense. So we give a name to the class of such type constructors for which you can do such things. And that name is functor. So in other words, a functor is basically like a container type or some kind of type in which this notion of mapping makes sense. So this list is a functor, bin tree is a functor, and this trace is a functor. We can ask what a functor is, and it says that you can ignore this thing, but it basically says that it is some kind of class where this thing makes sense. So in fact, if I, instead of, let's say I have this function on which I was multiplying 10 to everything in a list, and I could have written that as fmap, because that is the same thing as map when lists are concerned. And actually there is a language extension called derive functor. So here I could do that, and then it would basically derive the bin tree type for me. So let's try to see this with an example. Let me make a tree. Let's call it tree one, and let's say that tree has one something. Let's say the tree looks something like that. So I could try to use bin tree map, and I could say that maybe I should derive show because I want to print this. Otherwise, it will complain that I don't know how to print this. So I could use bin tree map to say that I want to increment everything in this tree, and it has incremented this node and it has incremented that node. But since I have done derive functor, it automatically knows that there is a way to define this notion of map on the type of trees, or rather the type constructor of trees, and I could just as well use that. So if you do if you enable this extension, then you can do derive functor, and it will automatically derive this kind of thing for you when it makes sense. I don't know if it works all the time. So by the way, this is an extension because I think the original Haskell language did not have that, but later people realized that for many types you can do this automatically, and this code is just boilerplate code. So you might as well just write deriving functor to do this automatically. So any question? If you are on Zoom, could you please mute yourself if you don't mind? No questions? All right. So I talked about this class called functor, and then I said that it is some kind of class on which you can do this map and it generalizes. But that is not really being very specific, because if someone gives me some kind of instance of functor, then how do I really know whether it is really generalizing map? And like the question, like always, is can we make this concept more precise? So remember that one of the things we do when we write functions is like we give a contract to them. So this is what we will do when we define classes. So for example, we had a class called ORD. And what is the contract that a type satisfying, or like an instance of the class ORD should satisfy? So it should be a partial order. Or for example, if I have one less than two and two less than three, it should have one less than three. So this law is called transitivity. So there are like a couple of laws you could use to characterize what it means for something to implement order. So just like that, there are a couple of laws that one must implement one must make sure that they follow when they use the use or implement the typecast, instantiate the typecast function. Here, this is done automatically. But for example, I could have said that instance bin tree a of I could have done this. So I could have said that fmap is basically implemented by trace map. For the case of bin tree, fmap is implemented by bin tree map. So what is the contract that we want our this class to satisfy? So there are two main laws of the functor class. The first thing is that when you define an fmap, the fmap should preserve identity. So this thing should satisfy this law. So id is the function that returns the same thing as its input. So let's say I have this tree over here, and I could apply the identity on this tree, it would give me the tree itself. And if I apply identity to each of the elements of the tree, that should also preserve the tree. So using map with the identity function and using map on the entire container or what have you, that those things should be the same thing. So this is the first law. And the second law is that this fmap should preserve composition. So let's say that I have a tree and I increment all the leaves of all the nodes of the tree by 1, and then I multiply everything by 10. So I could do that, or I could use this composition in which I go to a tree, go to a node, and then I add 1 and then I multiply 10 before moving on to the next node. And both of these should produce the same results. So in more abstract notation, we want to have this. Or maybe I could write, I could write it like that. So here is the composition. And here I did not use the composition notation, but essentially it's the same thing. I have written it like that. So some type, like some element, or some value v, and here I am using the same thing. So if I compose either on this side or on that side, the result should be the same. And here also I have not written the argument, but I could write the argument if I want, which is basically saying this. So do these two laws make sense to everyone? And you can actually check that these laws hold for this, like we sort of like experimentally check for this thing, but we can write a proof that bin tree map satisfies these two laws, and we can also write a proof that trace map satisfies these two laws. There are some types, like some constructors, for which you cannot define a functor instance, at least meaningful in a meaningful way, that meaningful way that satisfies these laws. One example is this. I will call this thing P, or it is P of C, or maybe I can call this functional. So the difference between trace and functional is that trace has this thing on the right, and here I have this on the left. So on this thing, you can't define a functor instance that looks like that has this kind of signature and follows this kind of laws. I will not go into why, but yes.
So what's the difference between saying loop type function and type function?
Sorry, I should have said function. Never mind. I should have said type. The difference is that if I said loop, I would put a tag over here, so that like it's not a synonym anymore. But that was a typo. So any questions? You have a question? Yeah.
So on the
No. I mean, that was just a comparison of like a different type class, but this has got nothing to do with orders. Yes. Yeah, I'm not saying that the tree is a search tree or like.
I actually don't. Where's the definition of bin tree?
Here.
Well, bin tree is actually not bin
tree. Yeah, this is the definition of bin tree.
Bin tree is the over.
Why is that?
Because otherwise, you don't want to try to
No, so if you want it to be a search, I don't understand. So if you want it to be a search tree, then yes, but this is a, just a tree, not a search tree or anything. Yeah. This is just a way of arranging the data. I'm not saying anything about.
Why do you need the order?
We don't. I didn't say that. Okay, so that is what functor is. There is one other class which I will briefly mention but not explain too much, which is called applicative. So by the way, there is another example of functor which is maybe. So I could have so before that, another useful thing to know is that ifmap is sometimes abbreviated like this. So what is ifmap is sometimes written like that, and the reason for that is like actually very nice. So it basically looks like function application which we write as dollar. So let's say that I have some element. So let's say I have just in, which is this 10 is basically sitting inside a just, and let's say I wanted to increment this particular 10. So I could do that by doing this, because I could do that by doing this, because it knows how like that maybe is a functor, and this does nothing if this thing was nothing. So this particular thing is sometimes written like this, because it's as if you are applying. Because it's as if you are applying this function on it, but not quite. You are like applying this function inside a wrapper. So there is another thing which is useful to know, which is that you can have this kind of thing, which is. I don't know the name of this, but this has this kind of type. So if you have a function that is inside some wrapper, and you have another thing which is inside some wrapper, and you want to use this inside that, then you could use this. So for example, if I had this function like that, and then I wanted to use it on just 10. So both of these are inside the wrapper, and I don't want to like remove the wrapper or anything. So I could use this kind of notation. And this is actually used in this manner. Let's say I have two functions, or let's say I have two things which are inside a wrapper, and I want to apply binary operation which is not inside a wrapper on both of them, then it is written like that. So what happens over here is that we first use this, and so let's see. So if I do this, then this basically becomes just 10 plus, and it is as if I have this function inside a wrapper. And once I have a function inside the wrapper, I can apply it to this thing which is also inside the wrapper using this particular operator. And in some cases, I want to put something inside a wrapper, which will make sense if the wrapper is obvious from the context, which it often is not. So for example, if I know that the wrapper is maybe, I could say put something inside a wrapper and then I say pure 10. Oh. Right? But if this particular thing is not, this wrapper is something else, then pure 10 means something else. So there is another thing called pure, which has this type that you can put something inside the wrapper. So both of these things are not really functors, but these are inside something. These are in a class called applicative. And basically applicative just means this, that you can do these kinds of things. There are some laws. I don't remember the laws for applicative, but think of applicative in this manner. And another thing is that before you want, you can have something to be applicative, it must be a functor before that. In the sense that if you have to want to use pure for some kind of wrapper, then before you can implement pure for some wrapper, you must have implemented fmap for that. So remember previously that I had asked this question and it said that the kind of ORD is that it is a constraint on types. But if I ask Haskell, what is the kind of functor? It will say that the kind of functor is something which takes type constructors as an argument, or like type constructors and puts constraints on type constructors. So for example, here I wrote functor trace where something, but trace itself is not a type. Just like bin tree is not a type, but bin tree is a type constructor. Right? Same. So that is as opposed to, never mind. That is as opposed to ORD, in which case ORD is not a constraint on type constructors, but it is a constraint on types. So for example, here I have two, which is an ordered type, but two is just a type. It's not a type constructor. So what we are doing here is this kind of thing is called a higher kinded type class, which is different from a type class, which is just on type. So there is something different about this functors or applicatives. So don't worry about the applicative thing too much, but just know that you basically can use these kind of methods on this class. So before I move on to the next topic, anyone has any questions? Okay, so the next topic is going to be about what I call I/O. So notice an interesting thing that in functional programming, we value purity. And what does that mean? Well, when we have functions from A to B, what they do is they assign every element of A with some element of B. And this does not do any kind of side effects, in the sense that evaluating some function does not mean that it goes and changes some kind of state of the world or increments some variable or something like that. And this is very different from what functions do in non-purely functional languages. So you might have a function call in C or Java where you call a function, and after you call the function, you get an answer yes, but maybe the variable x has changed. X was 10 before, now it has become 11. So this kind of thing is what is called a side effect. And the other thing is that the functions over here do not really change anything in the world. Like they don't really do anything. They just tell me how to, or not really how to, they just tell me what happens when I apply a rule on some kind of data. But we don't want our programs to just apply rules on certain kinds of data. We want our programs to be able to do things. Like we might want it to launch missiles or write to a database or something like that. So we want to be able to represent this kind of things in our language, and that we should not let that mess up the purity for the rest of the things we have. So how we are going to do that is by defining a kind of type constructor, which we are going to call IO, or Haskell people have called that IO. And let's say that I have an int. So if I have an int, if I want to define an int, that int must look something like this. So that int could be 5, or it could be the result of some very complex function applied to some complex argument. It could be like that, but it is deterministic and it doesn't really depend on what the state of the world is. A value of type int always denotes the same object regardless of where it is. Not completely, but almost. So, but we could have a notion of a number, which is, let's say I open some file and read something, or I ask the user for some input and I get that. So that kind of thing is going to be called IO int. So for example, if I want IO int, I could say something like that. And in this case, the X does not really denote the same object every time. So we are going to think of this sort of thing as not an integer, but it's a recipe to create an integer. So if you notice, what an Haskell program does, for example, over here, an Haskell program at the very end of it is some kind of an action. So these IO things are called actions. So here I'm saying, this is just a testing code, so this is not a great example. But here I am saying that what this program does is it tests these things. It is not. So in some sense, a Haskell program is a big kind of recipe to generate some kind of, or do some kind of side effects in the world. And this is the thing we are going to build. So yeah, we are going to have a lot of things which are dependent on some file input or some input from somewhere, or maybe some randomness which do not always denote the same thing. So we are going to wrap all of these things behind IO. And one way to think about this is, like I said, you could think of this as a recipe to create an integer rather than being an actual integer. Or you could think of this as an impure integer, whatever that means. And the idea is that whenever we have such an impure value, we are going to be able to always track the impurity. So for example, this particular thing, this bin binary tree is not an impure binary tree, because it doesn't really depend on outside context or anything like that. But when something does depend on it, we will want to be able to track it. So with that preamble, let us dive into some code and see how to actually use these things. So there is a very simple example provided by the standard library, which is called getLine. And what getLine does is, getLine is a string, but it's kind of an impure string in the sense that it gets a line from the input and that is the string it is. So that's what getLine does. And you could think of this as a recipe for producing a string. Namely, the recipe is to get something from the standard input. So there is that, and there is another function called putStringLine. I don't know how to pronounce this. So this function does not produce a string. It does something. So this particular thing, this is called unit. So just like you have tuples, so you have tuples like that. Like let's say you have a tuple with 2 arguments. You could have a tuple with 3 arguments. You could have a tuple with 1 argument, which is boring, but this kind of thing just contains one value, which is the tuple itself. So this is sort of like the saying void in Java or C++ or whatever. This is basically saying that this action does not produce a result that I can use. So here I have a string which I could use in further computations, but I could, so if I do put strln and then I do this, I build some kind of action which is the action of writing this thing on the screen. But this does not give me some particular new thing on with which way I can do something. So that is why this thing is unit as opposed to this thing is string. So let me explain how that works by actually showing how what I can do with this thing. So here, if I do get line, I have this string, but this is inside some kind of wrapper, namely the IO wrapper. So what will I, to be able to use it further for my computations or whatever I want to do, I need to be able to use this value. So the way to use this value is, so one might expect that there is a function like this. That takes something and just destroy, like takes it out of the wrapper. But there is no such function, because if there was such a function, then I could just, I would be able to take this X, for example, and I would be able to write unwrap X. Let's say that this X is this thing, and that would be of type int. But this is an impure integer in the sense that it depends on what the file says, but it does not have the IO tag in it. So we don't have anything like this. Instead of that, what we do have is something like this. So this, you pronounce this as bind. So if you notice, like, I don't know if you can see this up here, but the Haskell logo has two things. Like, one is a lambda, and on the outside of it is there is a bind symbol. Maybe I could show it sometime later. So let's look at the type of bind. The type of bind is something like this. So let's say that this particular thing does some action and produces some value of type B. And this particular thing wants that result, and it will do some action and produce something of type B. Then what I can do is I can take the thing from here and forward it to here, and let me just execute this function, and then I will be able to get to this point. So it is sort of doing this unwrap IO thing, but it is not exposing that to me. It is doing that job for itself. So let's actually try to show an example. So remember, getLine was IO string, and put strln was just like that. So this is exactly what we want, right? Because and then this is IOA, and then there is put strln, which is A arrow this, and so B over here is bat, and B over here is unit, and A over here is string. So if I wanted to take something, like take the result of this action and forward it to this action, I could use this bind. So let me write this little program called echo. And what echo will do is, echo will get a line and then forward it to put strln. I don't know why that's an error, but never mind. So I can run echo, and it just gives me the same thing which I wrote. Yes.
Does the type of echo guarantee that it's basically the identity of the side effects?
Sorry?
Does the type of echo guarantee? What did LO give all of that? say.
No, it doesn't.
Instead of some other text.
Right. So. No, the type does not guarantee that. For example, so putstln wants an argument, but here the argument of putstln is whatever the result of this is, but actually I could put some garbage there. Like I'm putting underscore, but let's just put x. Like underscore is just saying that I don't care about. So I could write this. And it has the same type, but it doesn't guarantee that. So I could run this. And it always produces the same thing because this X is not really used over here. So let us do some examples to see how we can use this machinery to build more complex things with I/O. So I will write this particular function. By the way, this string, it's just a synonym for a list of characters. So yeah, if I can use list concatenation. So this is list concatenation on strings. So I could have this function, and let's say I want to have define something like this. So the first thing I want to do is I want to get input, and let's say that this is someone's name. And so I will assign this to a variable. Like this is basically lambda notation. Like I can put parents, but I don't have to because of like how it parses. So then I could say this, right? And what did I do? Oh, yeah, this doesn't take two strings. So if I do greet and I say that my name is Avinisham, then it does that. So this is the way I can compose these I/O things together. So note one thing that this computation is pure in the sense that it does not depend on some kind of input. So after all, the program that you write will be some kind of an I/O, but usually the good practice is to be able to fragment in your code so that you can do as much pure computation as possible. So actually each of the programs have, or you can, if you want to compile and run a Haskell program, you create this function called, or create this action called main. And main has to have this type. And this is just one way to run this. Like, let's hope this runs. I don't know if it will. Okay, I think it's working. So yeah, if you want to run a Haskell program, you can create this main function and yes.
No, your greet reads from input. Does the same test type I/O apply to unit?
So yeah, type IO unit does not mean that it reads from the input. It basically means that it does not produce some kind of value that you can proceed forward with. So for example,
and it does, it is allowed to.
Yeah, it can do anything. Yeah. So the reason why that is unit and not something else is, like, contrast it with this. So here it says IO string, which means that it has a result of string, which I could use it in further computations. But if I am writing something to the screen, it doesn't have some result which I could use for further computations. I mean, it could, like, let's say if I call a process and then the process, let's say, exits with code zero, I could like make it an IO int, and then that int would contain a exit code. There are some libraries which do that. Yeah.
I don't know, I guess I could call the operation swallow. You could have something that's analogous to get one. It just swallows something green, but it doesn't actually return.
Yeah.
So the input now has been transformed by the fact that the first item has been eliminated. But it's not returned, it would be on the string. I guess, in fact, it could either be, it could do a swallow.
So is this like.
On the string, but just always returned by that.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, let's do that. So we saw this thing called pure previously, which put something inside a wrapper. So I could have a dummy IO int, which, or like, let's make it string. I don't know why. So this particular thing, it really does no computation, but it looks like it is doing some computation. It is always putting this particular string inside, the same string inside the IO wrapper. So I could use it like this. So and it works, but it is always the same value that it's going to print.
Is there any limit on how many IO operations something that's type IO is allowed to be more than one?
Yeah.
You. So it does something without it, the IO string, which has a side effect of the IO string. Well, it optionally does something with the IO string. So if it does something with the IO string, there's a side effect of it. It's a generic case of that.
Yeah, actually, since it's a degenerate case, like, that is why this is called pure, because it's kind of inside the IO thing, but it is called pure because it does not really do any input or computation. The type doesn't guarantee that. So that is why actually you can put a lot of things inside the IO this thing, but I will, like, whenever possible, it is a good idea to have like pure code so that you are making the guarantee that it is pure. I mean, when you are doing this, you are taking away that guarantee. So try to do that as less as possible. So let us look at this thing further and do some more things with this. So let's say that I wanted to ask first, what is your name? And then I could do that by doing this. And let's ignore this for a moment. And then it would produce something. Actually, it doesn't really produce anything. It produces, because the type of this is IO unit. So it produces an unit, which we can just ignore, because the unit value really contains no information. So I have another function which will consume this in this unit, and it will do nothing with it. But I could, after that, I could do this. So in this way, I'm chaining these actions together. So it does that. So this particular thing is just swallowing the unit result, which is always the same. I could have given this some name X, but I'm just calling it underscore because I want to ignore that. So actually there is a function called, I don't know what is this called. Like, I guess this could be called sequence instead of bind. So if you have sequence instead of bind, then you don't need to supply an argument here because it automatically just ignores the argument. So I instead of ignoring the argument explicitly, I could just use the use sequence instead of bind, and then it would do the same thing. Right? So now I want to introduce something that is that will simplify this notation. Well, actually, this notation is already not so bad because I think if you because of the way this thing is parsed, I think if you remove the brackets, it will just work fine, I think. Yeah, it does work fine, right? So, but there is actually a nicer notation, which is called the do notation. But when I use the do notation, it will look like an imperative program, but I want you to remember that this is just syntactic sugar for whatever we have here. So let's look at what that looks like. So in the do notation, you first say do, and then you write these things one by one, and it looks like that. So you don't have to write bind, you don't have to write the sequence because we are inside the do notation. But here, we don't just want to get line and ignore it. We want to be able to use the thing that is wrapped inside by get line. So instead of using this kind of notation, we will write this. So it's as if that I'm unwrapping this, but actually this is just desugared to this kind of syntax, but because what happens is this is just this is just being bound to this name, and like this thing is just being pushed to this. So I could just use that. Questions? Yeah.
I kind of like this. It's sort of monads from the bottom up or top down.
Yeah, I was.
I really find out this track of what's going on. Doing things so abstract.
Yeah, I was avoiding that word monad, but now it is here. It is. We will talk more.
Monads. I didn't use the word.
I was avoiding it on purpose. But next class we will talk like more about monads, because IO doesn't have to be the only monad. Like, you can take advantage of the do notation in other cases also.
And in fact, for at least people that I guess Moji did monads, I think in the abstract, I didn't think. But then when you want to incorporate a language, you want to think about, okay, how do I actually use it? And then say, okay, can I abstract away from this particular usage pattern to something more general? And monads come so concrete in the abstract, as opposed to being a pure tissue, just sort of business that they have put up, like, you know, include side effects and something that's purely functional while you're making all those side effects explicit.
Yeah.
As functions, but you're hiding it inside the monad, right?
Yes.
And that's really what's going on here.
So yeah, from now on, instead of calling this an IO wrapper, I will call this the IO monad, because that's the terminology that the community uses. So we can do further things inside the do notation. So let me just import data.char for some reason. And so I will have another thing in here. What I will do is I will have something like this. So there is this function which I imported from data.char. It's called toUpper. It basically transforms things into upper characters. So if I have a list, if I have a string, so strings are just lists of characters. I can use map to upper to do that, right? So if I want to capitalize the whole thing, I can do this. So notice that, actually, maybe I should have introduced this in a different way. So since this is inside do notation, I can use this kind of lets. And but this is basically just syntactic sugar like this. Like if I had to put this in here, I would say let this, and that makes sense, right? Because this entire thing is an expression, and I am just binding this name, big name, to this particular thing. So instead of writing it like that with the extra in, inside the do notation, you can have this. So does it work? Thanks. Yeah, right. So a couple of things about this, like remember that this is syntactic sugar. So for example, if I did this, this would make no sense because this is like that, and that doesn't make sense. Right? Because here let big name equal to two upper name in what? So you can't have this because then it will complain that it says the last statement in do block must be an expression. So it basically looks like an in without something. So this doesn't make sense. Another thing we cannot do is we can't have this because here it looks like I'm binding this thing to something. And then what? So this also doesn't make sense. Wait, what? Yeah, again, it says that this is a problem. And okay, so here notice that, so let me fix this. Yeah, so here notice that the type of this entire thing is this. And how did we get this type? It's basically because we are binding this to that and then using bind again, and ultimately what we are getting is what is the type of this. So each of these things are like chained by the bind, and ultimately the thing that you get is the type of this. So for example, if I wanted the last operation to over here to be another get line, by the way, when I'm doing this, it says that the last operation is get line. So the type of get line was IO string. String is a list of characters. So it is saying that it is actual type is IO string, but I have written over here this. So those types must match. So if I do greet 4 now, it will do that. And then it is looking for something else. So yeah, it is looking for this particular get line. So the last action in the do block must match the type of the entire do block. And this is basically just a consequence of the fact that this is just sugar for this bind operations. Any questions? No? Okay. So let me show you a few more examples on how to work with these things. So I want to write this program called DS. And what this does is it prints yes. And then this. So remember that this is syntactic sugar for this. Like ignore this thing. Like ignore whatever this result is. And then do the next thing. So instead of writing that syntactic sugar, I can just write it like that. And if I run this, this is like a loop, right? There is actually a function in the standard library called forever. And so looks like forever is not defined. So So if I do not want to write this loop in this kind of like explicit go-tos, I could use this kind of control flow operators which are available in this library called control.monad. Hopefully, if I'm not wrong. Yeah. So from control.monad, I have imported this operator, which is basically like a loop. So this just loops this action forever. So ES1 and ES2 have the same behavior. So let me show some examples of conditionals. So let's say that I want to have some particular thing which asks for a number from the standard input and says that it is positive if it is positive. So I will write this in do notation. So the first thing I will do is I will do get line. And I want the result of that get line. And right now this is a string. So it turns out that there is a inbuilt function called read, which can convert strings to the whatever you want. So in this particular context, I want an int. So this is read is kind of polymorphic, but its polymorphism is a little bit weird. Because over here it says that it's polymorphic in the return type. So in this case, if I use in as an integer later, after reading it, it will figure out what I'm using this as. But in some cases, it is not able to figure out. Like for example, if I do read 10, it is kind of confused because it actually I'm not sure why it is confused this time. Probably because it doesn't know what to parse it as. So I could specify this as float and it does that. But if this is used in a context later, like the type checker can figure out what this particular array needs to be instantiated to. So maybe I can call this in and then I can define it to be that. And if n is greater than 0, then have I shown this?
In your example, when you do string 10.0, let's say it's a type float, what happens if you stated the wrong information?
It will be a runtime exception, I believe. Yeah.
It doesn't stop. It's actually a mirror message. It's no different than the price of the.
Yeah, it's not very useful data information, I agree. So in this case, I could have like added this annotation that this is an int, but I'm not going to because it's going to be able to figure it out. So if this is greater than 0, then it's positive. I think I have to indent. I'm not sure if I have to indent. Have I shown this if else thing before? Okay, that's bad. So there is nothing magical about this. This is basically like you can write it in other manners also with like guards and everything else, all the other. So I can do if. So this produces 3. That produce, yeah. And I can, so these two things are basically expressions. So this if thing is an expression, I can nest this thing and. So I can do this. I could also.
So the bars insert the primitive form and then get this.
Yeah, the
macro for a particular kind of guard.
Guards. Yeah. So guards don't apply here because guards have to be used in the context of a function definition.
Oh, this doesn't.
Yeah, you can use this anywhere. In the sense, this is like syntax for function definition. This is just an expression. So this is just an if expression. I may have shown case expressions before. You could also write this like that, case n greater than 0 of, and then I could say if it is true, you do that. If it is false, you do that. This is also, but yeah, my point is that this if has nothing to do with IO. You if is just an expression. So yeah, maybe I should have talked about if before. I don't know if there will be an indentation error. Let's see. Okay, no indentation errors. So what is happening over here is that it is doing this, and then it is defining this, and then it is using one of these actions based on like whether this is true or not. So this entire thing is actually an expression which has type IO unit, but it kind of depends on like what the value of n is. Let me execute this. Right, that works. So another thing is that here I have used this read. I first extracted this value and then I use read on that. But instead of that, what I could do instead, and it's not necessary that this is a better choice, is I could use the notion of if map, which we were talking about in the beginning of this class. So remember that when I do get line has type IO string. And there is a function which is, let's say string arrow int for now. So if I want to do an IO, if I have an IO string and I want to get an IO int, how do I do that using fmap? Can I combine these two things with fmap? So I just do this, right? And that changes the thing inside the IO monad and it becomes an integer, but it still like lives inside there. I'm not saying this is better style, but it's just something you can do. And sometimes people do this. So yeah, you could do this. And I am doing the extraction after I convert that into an integer. So actually, instead of the ifmap, I could use this notation. Remember that this is just notation for ifmap. So yeah, any questions? No? Okay. So in the next class, we will look at more general monads and other contexts where we can use this bind. So we have already seen some of those contexts, like maybe is a context where we can use that. We can use lists in bind inside the list notation, and we will notice that list comprehension is actually do notation, but for lists. So yeah, that's going to be next class. Thanks everyone.